Hey, you oldies, listen to the children. Listen and act.
It gave me a voice. It gave me a bigger platform.
Good afternoon, and welcome to the award ceremony of the 2023 International Children's Peace Prize. Your Excellencies, honored guests, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, I'm Gina London, and welcome to London and this beautiful and historic setting. We have so many incredible people joining us here today, ambassadors from many countries, the Nobel Peace Prize laureate of 2015, Wieden Bushimaui. And I also want to say so thankful and how meaningful that it is to have so many dignitaries and NGO officials from all over the world. And from every corner of the world, viewers coming streaming in live from Facebook and Associated Press live stream. And as a former CNN correspondent, I also want to welcome, on behalf of KidsRights and the International Children's Peace Prize, the members of the international press. In short, the world is watching. And they're watching from right here in this magnificent remnant. This banquet house is all that remains of the once incredibly massive compound known as Whitehall Palace. From 1538 to 1698, this is where kings, here in this banquet hall, which was commissioned by King James I, would welcome notable guests. The throne that you see behind me, or the area where that throne was, kings would sit by and receive those guests. And above me still remains, from Baroque Flemish master Peter Paul Rubens, an incredible painting. And from that incredible sight of those years gone by to state dinners that are held in this very banquet hall to make an exceptional difference in the rights of a child and the position of children from anywhere in the world. And it is with pride to say that there are hundreds and millions of people who are reached and impacted and inspired by the message of each winner. And we understand from analytics, in fact, last year there were 2.2 billion people who received the message of the winner. And for this year's winner, whom of course you'll be meeting the finalists and the winner later today, it was a unanimous decision by the KidsRights Foundation Expert Committee. And with that, it is such an absolute honor to be able to welcome all of you here today to think about the impact that children can make in their day. It was a unanimous decision by the KidsRights Foundation Expert Committee. And with that, it is such an absolute honor to be able to welcome all of you here today to think about the impact that children can make in their world. Please join me in welcoming and honoring all of those children. And to officially open this ceremony, I now would ask you to also welcome the daughter of the patron, the late Archbishop Desmond Tutu of the International Children's Peace Prize. And Mpho Tutu is also an impactor of the world in her own right, an author, an activist, and the founding executive director of the Desmond and Leah Tutu Legacy Foundation. Please join me in welcoming Mpho Tutu.
Your Excellencies, esteemed finalists, distinguished guests, and members of the International Press Corps, I welcome you to the 19th celebration of the International Children's Peace Prize. Launched in Rome in 2005 at a gathering of the Nobel laureates, this award has become the most important recognition in the world of young people as creative, courageous change makers. My father, the late Archbishop Emeritus Desmond Tutu, was patron of the Children's Peace Prize from 2008 until his death in 2021. It was a role that had a special place in his heart. He also had a special fondness for London, the birthplace of his youngest and most wonderful child. Nice. My father would say, we must listen to the children. We must listen and we must act on what we hear. And we say, yes, we listen to the children, for the children are our future. We say the children are our future, not the ones dying of preventable diseases in Afghanistan because of embargoed AIDS and frozen assets, not those children, they have no future. We mean the other children.
Wow.
They are our future. No, not the ones bullied for being gay or trans or gender non-binary or just too different or just too much the same. And certainly not the ones with the parents in jail, not those children, the other children. We listen to the children, for they are our future, not the ones fleeing bombs in Ukraine. They don't want to be fleeing. They just want to be home, at peace. But peace requires talking to our enemies, so rather let the future flee than listen to the children who are our future. Well, not the ones facing genocide in Gaza. After all, they are terrorists with no right to a future. We mean the other children. They are our future. Not the ones who are refugees, dying in rickety boats on the high seas. Not those children. We mean the other children. They are our future. Not the ones whose homes are being swept away by the rising tides of climate change. The other children. They are our future. But who is left to fashion the future? Which children is it that we say we listen to for the globe? And whoever is incapable of recognizing this may be incapable of morality. Will we listen to the chorus of creativity they offer us as a chance to change our world? The children are speaking. No, they are screaming. Can we hear them? Will we heed them? The children are speaking. Anastasia, Sophia, and Anastasia are speaking. Aaron is speaking. Srinihal is speaking. They challenge us to choose the hard and courageous path of working for the justice that leads to peace. Our children are speaking. We must listen, and we must act. Thank you.
Thank you, Mpo Tutu. The children are the future, all the children. And when will we listen? We have an opportunity to listen right now to last year's winner of the International Children's Peace Prize. Raina Kawasaki, an advocate for the voice of children in politics, environment, and society in her home country of Japan, has made her now one of the leading, if not the leading, advocate for youth in Japan.
Raina Kawasaki is a young Japanese social activist. She was awarded the International Children's Peace Prize in 2022. At the young age of 14 years, she managed to connect Japanese youth to local politicians. Raina is a part of the Japanese government's Tokyo Bay Environmental Social Governance Infrastructure Project, which is aimed at creating a sustainable city that will impact 37 million people in the region. Raina was the youngest ever chief future officer for a biofuel jet company in Japan.
The winner of the 2022 International Children's Peace Prize, please join me in a warm welcome for Raina Kawasaki.
Honorable audience, good afternoon. 皆様こんにちは。皆様の前で再びお話しできることを光栄に思います。
It is an absolute honor to be invited back to this year's ceremony for the International Children's Peace Prize 2023. As I stand here, I vividly remember nervously sitting in the crowd at last year's ceremony, listening to past winners Kaylee and Nav's speeches, and being empowered and filled with anticipation as I prepared to take the stage. I hope and strive to be as encouraging and as inspiring as they were to honor this year's winner. Winning the prize last year has greatly elevated the scale of my impact. Just days after my award ceremony, I received tens and hundreds of emails from teachers nationally who told me they spoke about my work, our work, for their students for their morning assemblies. I had numerous youth coming up and telling me that the news of winning the International Children's Peace Prize made them feel that they were not alone in their want for action and pushed them to start their own projects. One of the high school students who lives in a rural area in Japan joined our organization and is now starting his own project for regional revitalization. He is rebuilding his community from the ground up. Another is leading her own project with her local government to get youth opinions involved in her local area. I do not claim their successes. I am just amazed at their work ethic and passion and the fact that I was able to inspire them. They have inspired me to work harder so I can widen their possibilities in the future. I also had the privilege and opportunities to collaborate with municipal and national governments. It started with the Prime Minister of Japan responding to my speech in Parliament. From there, I was able to speak on a panel for the Japanese National Cabinet on youth inclusion in politics. I also spoke for the Nobel Peace Laureate Conference in Korea last year. And I understand and I know that this is just the beginning. I want to use my platform to make youth seen, and that's what I've been doing for this past year. More specifically, I've worked with the city government of my hometown to establish partnerships with local middle schoolers to allow youth opinion to be directly implemented into city policy. My organization, Earth Guardians Japan, grew nationally from only having members in two regions of Japan to encompassing almost all regions, starting from Hokkaido, Kanto, Kansai, Chubu, and Kyushu. We have established one-on-one mentoring sessions for all of our youth. We have established a youth board to get more youth involved in our leadership. We have launched our first ever national lobbying campaign to establish the first ever UN Youth Delegate Program in Japan. We have sponsored numerous projects for youth activists in local regions. However, I think that one of my biggest impacts was to keep the conversation going and for people to know that there are young people in Japan who want a better future. We are not a disconnected generation. I know that I'm not something special. I know I'm not someone special at all. But I know that the fact that I want allowed free other youth to become spotlighted, and that's what matters to me. I think the biggest impact for me personally was that the pure realization that I am not doing enough. I felt this crushing yet positive responsibility that I have to be responsible for how my country goes forward, how my society is going forward. I have, and I believe we all have, become way too comfortable, becoming mere spectators in the scary world we live in. How many crises are we going to ignore before we take action? We have to keep the conversation going. For us youth leaders, our successes should not be on the backs of our leaders or society's failures. Our country's youth should not see leaders in society as a limitation. We should not be at a place where our activism stems from incompetence, but rather we have to work together with government, we have to work together with other societal factors to make sure to together create innovation and leadership. Today, look around you. We have to acknowledge and honor those that are not in the room here today with us. We have to acknowledge those youth that we have failed. Those youth that wanted to take action, that wanted to start activism, but was too filled with despair for society's failures. So today, I refuse just to be a speech maker. And I implore for the audience to not become, to not see these finalists, these nominated youth, as just a speech maker. They are not just a token youth who headlines an event. Let's think about how you today can include them in your organizations, your governments, your corporations. Anastasia, Sophia, and Anastasia are programmers, they're graphic designers. They are not just a token youth activist. Serena Hall is an investigator, an entrepreneur, an environmentalist. Don't just see him as just another youth. Aaron is a strong-willed campaigner, an activist, and a leader. He is not just another youth leader. They want for their projects to be furthered, not for them to be famous. Don't mistake their activism from hatred towards the system. They are actively trying to find solutions for society. So tonight, let's not sit comfortably in seats for tonight. Let's, you know, sit a little taller, look more presentable. Let's not just be mere spectators tonight and from tonight. Let us inspire these finalists as much as they have inspired us. Their story does not end with today's ceremony. For them, it is just the beginning, and we have to ensure that it's just the beginning for them.
私たち、ここに私たちのスピーチを聞いている皆さんに言いたいのは、ただ傍観者になるだけではなく、この youth、この青少年のために私たちが何をできるか、何を今日からするのか、みんなで一緒に考えていく、そのような社会にしていきたいと思います。 I will vow to make sure it is a world worth dreaming in for our finalists, our nominated youth. Tonight, let us all vow to make sure it is a world worth living in for all of us, for them. Thank you.
Renee, thank you for keeping the conversation going. Thank you for reminding each of us to not only be spectators, to embrace the impact that is ongoing of these not speech givers, but activists, of change makers, of solution finders. And as Rania talked about how her impact is continuing to grow since she was awarded the International Children's Peace Prize last year, the prize itself, since its inception, has continued to grow in its impact, not only giving voices to the voiceless young people, special people, I may say, but also for their impact with elevating these issues on a global stage through the press, through other organizations, elevating these important issues, all a part of the mission of the International Children's Peace Prize, the most important of its kind in all the world. Let's take a look back now at this very prestigious award.
The International Children's Peace Prize is an initiative of the Dutch KidsRights Foundation. Every year, this prize is awarded to a child who bravely fights for children's rights anywhere in the world. In 2005, the first Children's Peace Prize was posthumously dedicated to Nkosi. During his short life, he pleaded for the rights of HIV and AIDS-infected children.
We are normal. We are human beings.
The next year, former child slave Om Prakash received the prize for his unceasing work to combat child labor and liberate child slaves in India. Tandiwe from Zambia won the prize in 2007 because of her extraordinary effort for the right to education for all children. Maíra battles against violence in Vila Cruzeiro in Brazil. She was therefore awarded with the fourth International Children's Peace Prize. Maíra received the prize from Nobel Peace Laureate Desmond Tutu.
Just look, there's a little angel who goes and wipes the tears from God's eyes.
Talvez querer paz seja o mais comum no cotidiano da favela de Vila Cruzeiro. Não somos dignos de pena. O mundo é digno de pena.
Baruani from DR of Congo won the prize for his work promoting children's rights in the refugee camp in Tanzania, where he lives. In 2010, Francia received the prize. She campaigns for the right to name and nationality of children in the Dominican Republic. Kaylee won the prize for her commitment to the rights of children with disabilities in South Africa.
A lot of disabled people can't physically voice what they need and what they deserve. And I can.
Nkosi sikelele Afrika malo paganyisu
Desmond Tutu, patron of Kids' Rights and the International Children's Peace Prize, honored the winner of 2012. Kez received the prize for helping street children in the Philippines. In 2013, the prize was awarded to 16-year-old children's rights activist Malala.
I want to live in a world where education is valued in every corner of the globe and no one is excluded from it.
Neha received the prize in 2014 for her inspiring work helping orphaned and underprivileged children in both India and the United States, where she lives.
My message to the world is to convert empathy into action and make a difference in other people's lives.
On the 9th of November 2015, the prize was awarded to Abraham Keita. Keita leads the fight for children's rights and justice in Liberia.
My dream is to see a world where every child will receive justice.
Yeah! Let's go!
In 2016, the prize was awarded to Kekesha Basu from the United Arab Emirates for her extraordinary work as an environmental activist. In 2017, Malala Yousafzai presented the prize to Mohammed El-Junda. Mohammed is a Syrian refugee who fled to Lebanon with his family when life became too dangerous at home. Determined to fight for the right to education, he started a school in a refugee camp. The March for Our Lives initiators demands safe schools and safe communities.
We can and we will change the world.
They are true change makers and were therefore awarded the 2018 International Children's Peace Prize. 2019 was the year of Swedish climate activist Greta Thunberg, and of peace activist Divina Maloum from Cameroon.
We need to act. It's time for change.
They both received the International Children's Peace Prize for their fight for a safer and more sustainable world for their generation.
Together and united, we are unstoppable.
The 2020 winner is Bangladeshi social innovator Sadat.
There is a superhero who lives in all of us. Let's work together and make this world peaceful.
Sadat is an inspiration for today's youth. He's calling on young people all over the world to stop cyberbullying.
We are change makers because we are actively seeking solutions to the world's climate problems. We've recycled around 173,000 kgs of waste in the past 4 years, and it's just been an incredible journey.
Take the plunge. Now, there is no time to waste.
Action has to be taken.
Every step really does count.
You are not alone.
We are with you every step along the way.
Thank you.
The Expert Committee decided to award the 2021 International Children's Peace Prize to Vihan and Nav Agarwal.
Every day in Japan, children and youth face injustice. Because as a child in my country, you don't have a voice. And the consequences are devastating. Too many young people have taken their own lives. We want to be involved in decisions that impact our future. We spread QR codes all around the city to help youth give their opinion on what matters most to them.
World leaders, be open to disturbances. Be open to uncomfortable conversations from youth, for we are not fighting against you.
Rena is a real change maker and a rightful winner for the International Children's Peace Prize 2022.
The International Children's Peace Prize is not only a sign of recognition for these young winners. KidsRights offers them a platform to promote their message, reaching an international audience of millions. Set a great example of how children can move the world.
Children moving the world. We'll talk more about the meaning of the incredible prize itself. And of course, seeing each of those winners fills you with that sense of hope. And today, I hope our hope is renewed and refreshed as we learn the name of the winner of the 2023 International Children's Peace Prize. There were 140 applicants across 35 countries for this year's award, and the expert committee had its work cut out for them, but as I mentioned, those members did make a unanimous selection. And so now, let's meet the three finalists. Our first hails from the United States, where he is passionate about recycling batteries.
My name is Srini Hautamana. I am 14 years old, and I fight for a greener environment.
We're going to begin with a tragic e-bike shop fire sparked by lithium-ion batteries.
There have been more than 108 fires related to lithium-ion batteries. Those fires blamed for 13 deaths.
I found out that 15 billion batteries are thrown away each year worldwide. They cause contamination of the water and soil, and they cause fires at landfills. Do you know what that means for our lives, our health, wildlife, and our future? I'm on it, I got it, let's get it. I decided to stand up and act. I started an organization to recycle batteries. In my organization, we spread awareness to people on the importance of recycling used batteries. With battery bins, we collect and recycle the batteries properly, so that they don't end up in landfills and they don't cause pollution. What started in my living room is now an international organization with over 500 youth volunteers. You can't stop it, moving so fast like a rocket. We have recycled over 300,000 used batteries and educated over 15 million people. My dream for the future is to make sure that not even one battery ends up in the landfill. Take me higher. Because I want a cleaner, safer world for our generation and generations to come. I will fight until this is achieved.
Sri Nihal is in the top three of the International Children's Peace Prize 2023.
From his home in New Jersey to the banqueting house here in London, please give a warm welcome again. Applause for Sri Nihal Tamana.
Ladies and gentlemen, distinguished guests, and most importantly, fellow changemakers, my name is Sri Nihal Tamana. I am 14 years old, and I am the founder of a nonprofit organization called Recycle My Battery. Today, I am honored to be standing here before you as one of the top three of the International Children's Peace Prize. This opportunity is not just for me, but for all of the young individuals who believe in the power of change. My journey began with a simple question: what can I do to create a difference? It all began 4 years ago when I saw something shocking occur on the news. A lithium-ion battery completely exploded in a waste disposal plant in California. That was when I started to learn more about the importance of recycling used batteries properly. It was a wake-up call, not just for me, but for our entire society. That was when I decided to take action. I turned to my dad and I asked him what I can actually do to help save our environment. He said yes. That's how I started Recycling My Battery, with the vision of creating a safer, cleaner, and greener world for everybody to live in. Since our inception in 2019, Recycling My Battery has achieved a lot. Recycling My Battery has achieved a lot. We have become a global initiative with over 500 youth volunteers from all around the world. And together, we have recycled over 300,000 used batteries and educated over 15 million people on the importance of recycling used batteries properly. I want to share with you guys a small story on how we have made change on the international scale. So one day, a school in Switzerland actually learned about our work and was inspired to share it with their students. The school talked about our work and told the students to take inspiration and create a positive change in their communities. A few of the kids who were inspired later on reached out to me. They said that they were very inspired that the work that I was doing and that they would do all they can to actually help promote battery recycling efforts in their societies. They even pledged to start their own initiatives, and they showed me photos and videos of their initiatives. I felt very happy after seeing this, because I knew that my message and my organization was traveling all around the world, going to countries such as Canada, India, Switzerland, and beyond. And I'm very truly happy of this achievement. Today, I'm here to give you guys a valuable lesson. I want you guys to go out
and become change makers, innovators, and leaders. Just know, the age does not define your potential for success. You can do whatever you want to do in life, regardless of age. Do not let age stop you. If you have that passion, that determination, and perseverance, you will be able to achieve anything you want in life, regardless of age. Your passions and ideas will one day pay off in the future, and you will be able to create a change in the world. My message is simple. Get involved, start initiatives, or join existing initiatives. Do all you can to actually advocate for change to make the world a better place. I hope that we all can unite together so that we can inspire the next future generation of changemakers to do the exact same things that we are doing. So hopefully, we can together work together to make our Earth a better place to live for our future generations to come. I hope that we can all unite. My bad. So I would like to give a big thank you to our partners, including Call to Recycle, my fellow friends, my fellow teachers, and most importantly, everybody who has supported and Recycle My Battery's expansion. It's because of all you guys, Recycle My Battery is where it is today. I would also like to say that Recycle My Battery has future goals. We envision a world where one day, all the 15 billion batteries being thrown away each year worldwide reduces to zero. So zero batteries are thrown away each year worldwide. So we can make an even more battery-free world. I also want to create my very own eco-friendly battery, which uses 0% hazardous chemicals, so that this way, when the battery dies, it can safely be thrown away into the trash, as it's that sustainable. If this is a cause which you are interested in joining and supporting, please do feel free to join Recycle My Battery, so that together we can educate everybody on the importance of recycling used batteries, one battery at a time. Thank you so much for listening to my speech today. And
with group support, Aaron wants to help children and encourage them.
I want every child around the world with a parent in prison to know, no matter what your circumstances are, that you're not alone. My dream is to make life for those that have an incarcerated parent a lot easier, to bring light to such a grey area in society and make changes in this world. I will fight until my day's end in hopes that it will continue on past my life and we will see change in this world.
Aaron is in the top three of the International Children's Peace Prize 2023.
Representing 1% of the entire world's population, please join me in welcoming Aaron Scarth.
When I was 9 years old, my father went to prison. I watched him being thrown inside the back of a police van outside my house. When I was 9, I thought I was alone. I was wrong. In the UK, there are over 300,000 children with a parent in prison, and millions of us worldwide. But what do you think when you think of children with a parent in prison? Do you think about us at all? And if you do, what do you imagine? If you imagine a child who will not amount to much in life, you are not alone. The stigma around children like me is everywhere. It's awful. We are considered a lost cause before we have even had the chance to work out who we are and what we want to be. And I'm here to tell you that's wrong. Children with a parent in prison are constantly exposed to the narrative that we are likely to grow up and become offenders ourselves. This is simply not true, and no, we do not wear the imprisonment of a parent in prison like a badge of honour. However, we do need support. Parental imprisonment is an adverse childhood experience. It is trauma. And for a lot of us, we suffer in silence for fear of judgment. Our mental health is the prisoner, and our thoughts and feelings are locked away. We suffer for a crime we did not commit. The situation was way beyond our control. So here today, I invite everyone especially those who have been fortunate enough to not have experienced parental imprisonment. To be kind, we do not need your judgment. We need your understanding. We too are serving a sentence. I was lucky. When my father went to prison, I found a support group called Time Matters. Here, I met other children just like me, children who had hopes and dreams, well-mannered, hard-working, kind, decent young people. We came together because it was hard to talk to anyone else. Here, there was no judgment. It didn't matter whether we visited our parents in prison or whether it was better for us not to. We learned that you could love someone so much and be disappointed and hurt by them all at the same time. We learned that our worries, our mixed emotions are normal. And we learned that there is no such thing as the criminal gene. And yes, it's difficult. We worry all the time what other people think of us and our family. We wish we could fix it. At Time Matters, as well as getting support, we give support to one another. We are the leaders, the helpers, the change makers. We have spoken on podcasts, on the radio, on TV, and as research participants. The United Nations on the Convention of the Rights of the Child tells children that we have the right not to be discriminated against, that we have the right to privacy, and that we have the right to be protected from physical violence and psychological harm. Our rights can no longer be ignored. So today, I invite you, all of you, to also be the change makers, because having a family member in prison can happen to anyone, whoever you are, whatever your background or privilege you may have or may not have. Today, I invite the journalists to think about us when you write about the crime our parents have committed. I invite you to remember that our privacy and safety matters. I invite the police to understand that children witnessing the arrest of a parent is highly traumatic, so please do not neglect us at this time. I invite prison staff to make family visits as relaxed as children for children as possible. I invite probation workers to remember that there is a whole family to consider and that we want you to talk to us and find out about us. I invite teachers to understand that we cannot always concentrate in school and support us when our emotions are high. I invite the health services of each and every country to make a space for us and remember that we need trauma-informed support. And I invite anyone professional who might come across a child who is impacted by the criminal justice system to talk to us. Ask us what we want and need. We want to be included in decisions that affect us. We can no longer be ignored. And here today, I want to publicly thank my mother and my family for being my rock, and Dr. Lorna Brooks for this direction and amazing experiences you have provided, and to anyone who has dedicated their lives to help children with a parent in prison thrive, we are in your debt. Finally, I speak to any child with a parent in prison. Please remember, whatever our parents did or didn't do, this does not define us. This is only one part of our story, but this is not our whole story. We are musicians and artists. We are sportsmen and women. We are philosophers and writers. We speak many languages and are rewriting history, and we matter. And if any child with a parent in prison is listening to this, please remember, you are not alone, and it's not your fault. Thank you for listening.
Aaron, you are a change maker. Your personal story is incredibly powerful. You felt alone, and you have helped so many others who have also felt alone, and you are not defined by that. You are defined by so much more. You have come through a fire and are lighting a fire under so many of us today. Thank you for that. And speaking of fire, our next section is an opportunity for us to reflect on the power of fire, in particular, the firebird that is the symbol of Igor Stravinsky's breakthrough ballet that catapulted him to international fame, the firebird of the same name. He drew on that ancient imagery of rebirth, of beauty, of hope. And it is really what connects KidsRights and the work that it does, because the symbols and the values are very much the same. We live in a world, as Mpho Tutu explained in her presentation, that is dark and evil, and yet there is still good. And the future belongs to all of us, and especially the children. So please join me thinking about the rebirth and the symbolism of hope and strength and your inner confidence of making a change in the world, just like the Firebird, as we hear from the South Bank Sinfonia Orchestra, the finale of Firebird. Excellent. Thank you so very much. And I hope each of you imagine yourself taking a feather from that firebird and using it to harness your own power for good. Because our third finalist, our group of finalists, are three girls who are harnessing good for their war-torn country of Ukraine. Sofia Tereshchenko, Anastasia Feskova, and Anastasia Demchenko do not live currently in their home countries, as you can imagine, each of them living somewhere else. And in fact, only two of them are able to join us today, as unfortunately, Anastasia Demchenko was not granted the visa from the British Customs and was unable to join us here in person, demonstrating and illustrating the plight of not only children refugees, but of refugees all over the world, the difficulties that they endure.
My name is Anastasia.
My name is Sofia.
My name is Anastasia.
We are from Ukraine and we fight
for the rights of refugee children.
Because in war, children suffer the most.
We know because we saw it with our own eyes.
I remember everything.
The bombing.
The air raid siren.
The fear.
We escaped our country not knowing where to go.
I was torn apart from my family.
I live here with my mother, and my dad and my brother are both in Ukraine. It is really heartbreaking for me, especially because we were always like a very like tight-knit family, and he wasn't here for my 18th birthday. He's probably not gonna be here for my graduation, and it kind of feels like we're just running out of time that I could spend together. I still worry a lot about my parents, my friends, and I still have an application with air raid alarms, so I know when my family is in danger. I don't know how they are, so I just wait until someone calls me or texts me.
Anastasia, Sofia, and Anastasia met each other online. While working on a different project, they were deeply touched by the story of a young boy who crossed the border, all alone, with no parents. They felt the need to step up and decided to make a change. They start creating two apps for refugee children.
One for young children fleeing their own country.
Through this app, they can understand where they are, call for help, and communicate with local people. And the second app is to help older children who have already reached their destination.
To help them integrate.
And build lasting relationships with host communities.
With our app, we want to help every refugee child in the world.
Children need to be protected,
educated, and deserve to live their lives free from trauma.
This means our work needed now more than ever.
Kids are the world's future.
And we are the world's now.
Protect kids to save our future.
Anastasia, Sofia, and Anastasia are in the top three of the International Children's Peace Prize 2023.
Please join me in welcoming on the stage Sofia Tereshchenko and Anastasia Feskova.
Dear ladies and gentlemen, we are so grateful for the opportunity to be here. You might hear the tremor in our voices, and unfortunately, it's not only because of our pledge to stand on this stage, but also because of our experience. 2 weeks before the full-scale invasion, we, as enthusiastic teenagers, applied as a team for a technology competition. At that time, we lived a completely different life and had completely different ideas for the application, and we did not expect that the worst-case scenario would soon become our new reality, that we would need and want to do our part to help with the worst problem imaginable alongside experiencing it. 24th of February 2022 is forever carved in the memory of every Ukrainian. This day changed our habits, our life values, and our future. It's a day when adults cried while leaving behind everything they worked for their whole lives. It was a day when we, the children, were forced to grow up and learn to take such responsibility for ourselves rapidly. You might have heard of the 11-year-old boy from Zaporizhia who evacuated to Slovakia with nothing else but a polythene bag, passport, and phone number of relatives abroad. He was all alone in this scary journey, and unfortunately, this story wasn't rare. It's the story of 2.3 million Ukrainian children with no choice but to flee from Russian full-scale invasion and look for shelter abroad. Scattered around the world, we felt a devastating unfairness, not only for ourselves, but also for all the Ukrainian kids fighting for their future. So 2 weeks before the competition deadline, we decided to reunite and turn our pain into a global technical solution. Our superpower was our personal experience, which we used for the sake of many. No one can better understand the situation of refugee children than those who experienced it. At the same time, we recognize that help for conflict-affected people comes in many different ways. Therefore, for our first application, REFI, we focused on functions that we thought were crucial for the survival of the child. Our team tried to give a lonely refugee child a sense of faith and safety on their way to escape. Later, we realized that even if a young person is safe physically, there still can be a war going on in their head, the war which makes us feel trapped and isolated from the world around us. This is why our second application, Sweetie, is for young people who are already settled and physically safe, but feeling lost, isolated, and misunderstood in their new environment. To continue expanding the scope of our impact, we founded the youth civic organization Sweet, which means world in Ukrainian. Our goal is to use the experiences of refugee children around the world to help them in facing the hardships of resettlement. In the face of adversity, the human spirit can either be shattered or forged into a powerful force for change. Thanks to the innovation and to our hosting communities, we were strong and brave enough to fight for change. And thanks to the International Children's Peace Prize, we are here now sharing our experience and message with the world. We developed our apps by turning our pain into power. Our work is not just lines of code. It's a recognition of the importance of children's physical and mental well-being in crafting a better future for all of us. Сьогодні ми є голосом усіх українських дітей, які були змушені покинути Україну заради безпеки, проте продовжують поширювати нашу культуру і змінювати світ. Ми разом здатні творити зміни від імені нашої країни. Thank you.
Protecting the earth by recycling batteries. Protecting the lives of children's hearts and their place in the world so they don't feel alone by encouraging children who may have a parent in prison. Thank you, Shrina Hall. Thank you, Aaron. And thank you, Anastasia and Sophia, for encouraging, protecting, and connecting refugees. Each of these three finalists are worthy of their voice being amplified. And you will learn soon which one of them is this year's winner. But before that, let's hear from the co-founder and the director of the Mandela Institute for Humanity.
Ladies and gentlemen, meet Ndaba Mandela, an author, an activist, a grandson carrying Nelson Mandela's luminous legacy. Ndaba experienced deep loss, losing both parents to HIV. Raised by his iconic grandfather, resilience became his narrative. He founded the Africa Rising Foundation. He created the Mandela Institute for Humanity. And in 2018, he stood alongside Prince Harry and Sir Elton John. Together, they amplified the battle against HIV and AIDS. Ndaba doesn't just preserve a legacy, he propels it, unlocking potential and crafting a united future.
Keeping the legacy of his grandfather alive and introducing his grandfather's work and his passions to a new generation, please join me in welcoming in person Ndaba Mandela.
Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, and of course, the International Children's Peace Prize finalists. The first time I met my grandfather, I was 8 years old, and my parents told me that we're going to see him in jail. And of course, I didn't understand that he had been kept in isolation. He had been removed from Robben Island, and he was kept in a place called Victor Verster, which was a house. And so when they told me we're going to see him in jail, I pictured a house, concrete bars with dogs and security. But when we got there, it was a house, nicer than the house that I lived in. There was a swimming pool. I never had a swimming pool. There was a VCR. We watched The Neverending Story for the first time. I met a chef. I never knew what a chef was. And we had delicious food. And of course, we met the man himself, our grandfather, Nelson Mandela. Hey, how are you? How old are you? What's your favorite subject at school? And for the first time, that was what I had an idea of what I wanted to do when I grew up. Kids want to be pilots. They want to be lawyers. I told myself, when I grow up, I want to go to jail. A few years later, my grandfather came out of jail. And I remember we were still living in Soweto at the time, and it was about 3 o'clock in the afternoon. I was playing marbles with my friend, and my parents had not come home from work yet, because parents only come home later in that evening. And so as we're playing marbles, this black BMW drove up to us, and out jumped a man wearing a suit and tie, and he came directly to me, and he said, "Are you Ndaba?" And I said, "Yes," in surprise. And he said, "Well, I've been sent by your grandfather to come and fetch you. Will you come with me?" And I said, "No, no, no." And he said, "Do you want me to get fired? Are you stupid?" And I'm like, "No." In the back of my mind, I'm thinking, stranger danger. And eventually the man gave up and he left. And so when my father came home later that evening, I told him what had transpired. And he told me, "Ndaba, if that man comes again, you should go with him." And so, lo and behold, later that week, that man came back, and I jumped with him, and we went off to the leafy white suburbs of northern Johannesburg. And as we approached this gate, the electric gate opened up, and we drove inside, and there was security. There was policemen. We got into the house, and there was maids, there was chefs, just a whole host of people getting busy. And Mama Oli, I had met her for the first time, who was my grandfather's cook. She was the size of a small house. And she made me the most delicious sandwich. And as I was sitting there finishing my sandwich, my grandfather came in to tell me that he was going to send my father to university. And I would stay with him during that time because he didn't want my father to worry about me. He wanted him to focus on his studies. And so that week, I moved in with my grandfather. Now, growing up with my grandfather was quite tough. I remember him walking past my room and seeing that my room was upside down, untidy. And he called me like this. And he said, "Ndaba, this is not the way to live. You have to be neat. Everything has to be in its place." And he showed me how to fold a shirt. And he showed me how to fold pants. And he even showed me how to make up my bed. And he showed me how to use a medicine ball to do exercise. Because he told me that mental and physical vitality go together. I'll never forget this one day where I was having dinner with my grandfather. I must have been about 13 years old. And he says, "Ndaba, you are my grandson. Therefore, people will look at you as a leader. Therefore, you must get the best marks in class." And I was like, "Whoa, whoa, 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 the pressure, the pressure. Oh, the pressure." And you know, much later in life, I realized that parents put pressure on us not because they want us to fail. They put pressure on us because they want to see us the best side of ourselves. They want us to challenge ourselves, right? And so when parents put the pressure on you, they are showing you how much they love you. They are showing you that you have much more potential that you can achieve than what you think you can achieve. And so young people, when parents put pressure on you, do not see it as punishment. See it as them encouraging you to achieve the best side within yourself. Now, my mother died in 2003 of HIV/AIDS. In 2005, my father died of HIV/AIDS. And so our family had to come together to decide, what are we going to tell the world of how my father had died? And so one of my cousins said, well, HIV/AIDS doesn't kill you. It kills your immune system, so you're unable to defend yourself against common colds and flus. And my grandfather said, no, we shall not do that. We shall simply say that the life of my son was taken by HIV/AIDS. And so we went outside where the table was set up, and we all stood behind my grandfather as he read that statement. And it was for the first time that a prominent family in our country of South Africa had actually disclosed the actual cause of death of one of our loved ones. And that began a chain where we started to break the stigma that exists around HIV/AIDS. People were dying in silence as if they had done something dirty or ridiculous. No. You know, HIV/AIDS was like any other disease, like tuberculosis, like emphysema, like cancer. And we had to make sure that our people were able to put this disease on the table and tackle it so we could fight the stigma that existed on HIV/AIDS. But ladies and gentlemen, we all have dreams. We all aspire to achieving something. Here we are as change makers, coming together to celebrate the little difference that we have made in our community. It all begins at home. There's a reason why God has given us two ears and one mouth, right? So we can listen more than we talk. So when we want to go and make a difference in our community, it is important that you go and listen and you ask the advice of those very same people who are suffering or who are facing those challenges. Because often enough, those very same people who are suffering and are going through challenges have the solution of how you can help them. So let us go there and let us understand so that when we're building these solutions to these challenges, we are building it together with the people that we are trying to serve. A leader, ladies and gentlemen, is not about being the best. A leader is not about being number one. No. A leader is about serving those who can't serve themselves, speaking for those who can't speak for themselves. And this is what we have seen in these three finalists today. They have gone out of their way not to only look for what they are needing, what they are set about, but to also gather those people in their community to build solutions as a community. So I want everybody right now to stand up with me, and I want you to repeat these words. Now, these words that I'm going to say, I want you to say them with conviction. I want you to say them as if they are your own words. And as we say these words, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to put our hands up like this. We're going to put our hands out like this, right? Are you ready? Are you ready? Are you ready? Okay. I am a leader. I am a leader. What I can dream, I can achieve. It is in our hands to work together to make this world a better place. I thank you.
Ndaba, I am confident that your parents and your grandfather would be most proud of you. And I hope as you pushed your hands out, you meant what you said, and that you will listen more than you speak as you go through your next steps. And speaking of steps, as you see the people who are coming over here, they are from Voices 8, one of the finest vocal ensembles in all of Britain. And they, along with the wonderful orchestra here, are going to be sharing with you the Lux Aeterna from Sir Edward Elgar. And we look forward to joining and listening with both of those ears as they perform. Thank you. Voices 8 and the South Bank Sinfonia Orchestra. Thank you very, very much for that rousing performance. And next, It is such an incredible privilege to be here with you today and have the honor of introducing to you the founder and chairman of the KidsRights Foundation and the International Children's Peace Prize. Please, a warm welcome for Mark Dillard.
Your Excellencies, distinguished guests, dear finalists, Aaron, Three, Anastasia, Sofia, and Anastasia, and dear new and old friends, welcome, and thank you for coming today to celebrate together the International Children's Peace Prize 2023. We are grateful that the World Summit of Nobel Peace Laureates are endorsing us for 19 years already. We are grateful for the support of all our partners to make this happen. And we also like to welcome a new partner, H&M. My Swedish is a little bit rusty, but Tack så mycket. I hope it was well. And especially, I like to welcome very dear old friends, Siodin Yousafzai and his wife Topakai, the parents of Malala. We have such a long history together. I still remember that we received an handwritten letter for the International Children's Peace Prize, where we could read the remarkable story of a girl from the Swat Valley who dared to demand education for girls, which was denied by the Taliban regime. Malala was still unknown to the world and nominated in 2011 for the International Children's Peace Prize. She became a finalist, like the wonderful finalist today. This sparked the start of an incredible journey. In 2013, she received the International Children's Peace Prize, and later, as a Nobel Peace Laureate, she awarded the International Children's Peace Prize twice. Malala said, "My dad did not clip my wings." And Siodin, her father, wrote a book about this remarkable journey with the title, Let Her Fly. Ladies and gentlemen, many youngsters around the world have the feeling that their wings are clipped. They are not at the tables where far-reaching decisions are made. They see what is happening with the world. The climate crisis, the wars, the poverty and inequality, and they are very worried about where we are going. And their worries are right. In this year's 11th annual edition of our KidsRights Index, where together with the Erasmus University, we have reviewed 193 countries' children's rights situations, we see, substantiated by facts, that we can speak of an unprecedented polycrisis. My personal opinion is that at the root of all these crises is a crisis of values. We developed over the years, a machine of progress and growth and individualism that is dictating our lives. And it seems to be unstoppable and is backfiring now enormously. If we step back for a moment, and if we look at the crisis of values in a historical perspective, we see remarkable tipping points that nobody saw coming. At the end of the 19th century, women stood up and asked to be heard, asked for equal rights and the right to vote. We all remember the brave suffragettes. And society, step by step, accepted these new values. In the 20th century, the Afro-Americans stood up and demanded equal rights and launched the civil rights movement. Now, in the 21st century, we see what the International Children's Peace Prize statuette is expressing. A child or youngster that is trying to push, trying to move the world, and it is not easy, it is pushing uphill. Like today's finalists do, and like Malala Mkhosi-Johnson and other International Children's Peace Prize laureates did. And ladies and gentlemen, they are not alone. It is a silent revolution and has already started. Many, many youngsters are very worried about the direction where this globe is rolling. And they are developing other inner values. It's a silent inner revolution and a culture change, whether we like it or not. They demand to participate and say that you have to draw the line somewhere. They want to be ambassadors of another world, a better world. And this is happening and gets more and more traction by the day. KidsRights has been empowering these young change makers for 20 years now. And to facilitate them even better, we started our so-called State of Youth. Launched in September 2019 during the Nobel Peace Summit and the day after at the UN Youth Summit at the UN in New York. Through this first ever borderless digital state, we connect and facilitate young changemakers around the world. We invite them to voice their opinions and make plans for positive change in their own community. And we facilitate them with a training, a toolkit, and if needed, seed money. In only 4 years' time, State of Youth has 270 chapters on the ground in 40 countries in the global south and connects online youth in 87 countries. Just this past year alone, the State of Youth reached 112 million youngsters. In the coming year, we are heading north, starting in Europe. So, ladies and gentlemen, fasten your seatbelts. I just heard that one of our chapter leaders from Pakistan managed to come, and he paid his ticket through GoFundMe, if I heard it well. And his name is Aljan. Aljan, where are you? You are somewhere seated. You're there. Okay, please stand for a moment. Hi, Aljan. Aljan and his chapter had the idea to develop portable, smart street schools in old ship containers, providing free education for underprivileged children. And they succeeded in scaling and are scaling this initiative, eh? Aren't you, Aljan? And it's running on even on solar energy, isn't it? Yeah, well, really great. Well, just one of the inspiring examples what these youth-led chapters are doing. So, great, and thank you and your team. Well done. Ladies and gentlemen, currently State of Youth is one of the fastest growing youth communities worldwide, and we can speak of a real movement. It's a snowball. Today, the world is home to the largest generation of youth in history, with 1.8 billion youth worldwide. So, one out of five people globally. The potential is huge. Maybe you're thinking, or one could think, that all these projects they do in their communities are so little, and maybe not spectacular compared with the problems the world faces. But still, we felt that we had to tell you today what is silently growing. It's like seed, many, many seeds in all corners of the world. And it is change bottom up. And it keeps hope and love alive in a world that is at the edge of destroying itself. All of you, each and everyone here, is invited to join this movement or back them up and let them fly, and to help to push this globe in the right direction. Please, let us make this an intergenerational alliance. Please think about what you can contribute. As our dear patron Desmond Tutu said, do your little bit of good where you are. It's those little bits of good together that overwhelm the world. Thank you.
A change maker who saw a need and created not only a foundation to support the rights of children all over the world, but to initiate and establish this prestigious award that we are here to celebrate and learn about and join in that movement, that values revolution of the International Children's Peace Prize. Thank you again so much, Mark, for your heart, your commitment, and to each of you for supporting and being a part of this movement. Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, viewers all around the world, we are almost to the finale of this year's International Children's Peace Prize. Will it be Shri Nahal? Will it be Anastasia, and Sophia? Will it be Aaron? We will learn this in just a moment. But first, it's important to remind you once again that every year, as Mark said, so many apply, so many are impacted, and that impact ripples out and ripples out, and we hope that it continues. And it is signified, as you saw in the video and as Mark mentioned as well, this significant symbolic award that is carved individually every year by the wonderful artist Inka Inkik. And of course, it's called in honor of the first award recipient posthumously, but with such a legacy that he continues to leave behind, the Ngozi, in honor of Ngozi Johnson. And in addition to this incredible child putting the world against the odds in motion, each winner of the International Children's Peace Prize also receives the Desmond Tutu Study and Care Grant to enable him or her to obtain an education to help them move that world even, hopefully, more successfully. And furthermore, the International Children's Peace Prize is accompanied by a project fund of 100,000 euros to go toward a project that's invested by KidsRights that is closely, of course, related to the passion and the project and the impact of the final of the winner of that award. Over the past 19 years, KidsRights has directed more than 100,000 vulnerable children and supported them through this project fund. Remarkable achievement. Remarkable achievements here, remarkable achievements throughout the world. And in addition to this traditional award, it is also a tradition of the International Children's Peace Prize to have an adult, the Nobel Peace Prize laureate, be the one who actually gives that award, hands that award over. And that is, of course, as Mark also alluded to, because the International Peace Prize was launched for KidsRights during the World Summit of the Nobel Peace Prize Laureates Gathering in 2005 in Rome. And this year, as I've alluded, we do have in our presence the winner of the Nobel Peace Prize of 2015.
Please join us in welcoming a true advocate for peace, a remarkable leader, and a steadfast believer in the power of dialogue, Widad Buchamawi. In 2011, she shattered norms, becoming the first woman to lead the Tunisian Confederation of Industry, Trade, and Handicrafts. A vital figure during the Tunisian Revolution, Widad co-founded the Tunisian National Dialogue Quartet in 2013, a coalition pivotal in orchestrating a peaceful transition of power. Their efforts were globally recognized when they were awarded the Nobel Peace Prize in 2015. Recognized as one of Africa's most influential businesswomen, Widad's commitment to her nation and democracy is unwavering. Her words and actions continue to inspire us all. Ladies and gentlemen, Mrs. Widad Buchamawi.
Please join me in welcoming to the podium, Widad Buchamawi.
Thank you so much. Ladies and gentlemen, excellencies, dear finalists, dear children, thank you so much. I'm really very happy, excited to be here, and you made my day today. You are the inspiration, you are the present, you are the future, and you are our dream. I'm really delighted to be here with you today. Thank you, Mark Dullert, for having invited me at this edition of the International Children's Peace Prize. The rights of children are very important today more than ever, and we should all stand up to make this world a safer place for them. My topic today as businesswoman, as entrepreneur, is about a powerful partnership that has the potential to shape the current and future generations for the better. But if you allow me, I'd like to share with you an important and exciting event happened in my life. Since yesterday, I became a grandmom for the first time. Let's say a young grandmom of a wonderful granddaughter. Her name is Julia. I left her and I came here to see you and to appreciate your achievement. To be frank with you, I'm both happy and worried. As we live a world in a perpetual hostility, war, conflict, thousands of babies, children, are injured, killed, or forced to leave their home countries, like in Ukraine, in Gaza today. However, I remain convinced that you, dear children, are capable of changing this world. You just have to believe it and act. You have to act today, not tomorrow. That's why I'd like to tell you a little bit about my background, because in many ways it echoes my path. I was discreet by nature and would rather avoid the spotlight. I was usually reluctant to get involved in public life. Suddenly, I was thrust to the forefront of the public scene and found myself dealing with international media, with television teams from all over the world, seeking interviews. Why? Because I received the Nobel Peace Prize in 2015 with my colleagues in Tunisia, the Tunisian National Quartet. I was not really prepared for the sudden and unexpected turn of events. However, in the middle of it all, I did not forget who I was and where I came from. I could not see my achievement in life as having been possible without the help of my family. My father, my late father, comes to my mind when I think about power. I grew up in my father's world, as he was my first teacher. He was the one who guided my first steps. He taught me how to become an entrepreneur and how to help others, my community, my country. He taught me also how to be creative, how to be honest, and how to be a social activist. Indeed, the role of businesses, let's say entrepreneurs, is important in empowering young minds. Entrepreneurs are not merely profit-driven entities. They are engines of innovation, employment, and social change. Think about my fellow Nobel Peace Laureate, Mohamed Yunus, what he did for women with microcredit and social business. It was genius. Or companies, private companies, that have a strong corporate social responsibility to give back to the communities. The entrepreneurs would have the power to create opportunities for youth, offering them a platform to develop skills, gain experience, and contribute to the workforce, and preparing the youth for the challenges of the professional world. Moreover, businesses can serve as incubators for innovation and entrepreneurship by cultivating a culture of creativity and providing role in shaping future leaders. And we can do it together. Businesses can empower the younger generation to take risks, learn from failure, and contribute to social progress. Now let's delve into the realm of philanthropy and its impact on the youth. It's not just about financial contribution. It's about investing in human potential. Mentorship programs, sponsored skills, development, workshops, also by providing guidance, resources, and opportunities and supportive environment. By aligning philanthropic efforts with businesses' goals, companies can create sustainable impact and foster a sense of purpose among their employees and customers. This integrated approach not only benefits the community, but also enhances the company's reputation and brand value. Young people growing up in a world where diversity is encouraged and more likely to develop open minds and empathic hearts, preparing them to tackle global challenges together. Together, we can create a world where every young person has the opportunity to reach their full potential and contribute to the betterment of society. So, I call on the business community and the philanthropic world to please invest as much as you can in the current and the future generation. Your help is needed more than ever. Young people are not our future. They are our present. And KidsRights Foundation has made it crystal clear by creating the International Children's Peace Prize. Thank you so much, dear Mark. Thank you so much, all of you. And thank you so much for your attention, dear young leaders. Remember that all we need is love, and love is just all we need. Thank you so much.
We did Bushamawi, what inspiring words, not only about the impact you have had being brought up by an entrepreneurial family and creating that entrepreneurial spirit yourself, but also congratulations on the birth of Julia, the future change maker that I'm sure that she will be. And now, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, we are at that moment where you are about to learn the name or names of this year's recipient of the 2023 International Children's Peace Prize. And to introduce, I'm excited to be able to tell you that the person who is an expert committee member of the KidsRights Foundation, and who is also a member and a former chairperson of the United Nations Committee on the Rights of the Child, which of course is the highest organization in the world advocating for children. He is joining us by remote from the United Nations in New York. So please join me in welcoming Benyam Mesmer.
Thank you very much. We report Expert Committee, the National Children's Peace Prize 2023. The Expert Committee congratulates the finalists of the International Children's Peace Prize 2023. Ian Scott from the UK for his fight against discrimination of children with incarcerated parents. And Sri Nihal Tamana from USA for his consistent efforts to safeguard the environment by recycling batteries. They're addressing some of the most pertinent and overlooked issues around the world. In the process, helping us create a world that is fit for all children. And they rightfully deserve to be among the top three finalists of the International Children's Peace Prize 2023. After thoughtful consideration, the expert committee decided to award Anastasia Demchenko, Sofia Terechenko, and Anastasia Feskova from Ukraine, the International Children's Peace Prize 2023. The expert committee is moved by the determination and resilience of these three girls from Ukraine, who, despite being children themselves, wanted to help those in a very vulnerable situation to ensure their safety and well-being. Inspired by powerful stories of Ukrainian children who were forced to cross the borders alone and became refugees overnight, they set out to address the needs of these forgotten children. Being young victims of war themselves, they were able to immediately connect and understand the challenges faced by the children and youth in their host communities. These girls, who had never met each other in person, and had to flee to different countries and were cut off from their families, decided to stand up for the rights of refugee children. In different time zones, in the darkness of the night, they developed their plan. Their apps, Refi and Sviti, help young refugees in finding access to basic amenities in and social and moral support in their host communities. Their initiative is crucial to realize the rights of children to life with dignity, which is contained in Article 6 of the Convention on the Rights of the Child, and advances the rights of refugee children to receive protection and humanitarian assistance, which is found in Article 22 of the Convention on the Rights of the Child. Anastasia Demchenko, Sofia Tereshenko, and Anastasia Feskova are true change makers, and their apps will positively impact the lives of refugee children around the world by facilitating their effective integration in their host countries. Millions of unaccompanied children are on the move around the world due to wars, climate change, socioeconomic and political factors. And these girls embarked on an incredible journey to assist such vulnerable children through a widely accessible solution. These three girls are not children counting their days, but making their days count. For this remarkable initiative, which can and will improve the lives of millions of refugee children worldwide, they are declared as the rightful winners of the International Children's Peace Prize 2023. Thank you very much.
As the press is descending, Anastasia and Sophia, and of course, Wydad, please join with the Nkosi at your leisure to accept, receive, and to hand over the coveted 2023 International Children's Peace Prize Award, the Nkosi.
I still remember it's 24th of February 2022.
I remember everything. The bombing,
the air raid sirens, the fear.
Happened. This is Ukraine's capital. What seemed unthinkable in the 21st century is now underway.
Our reports of large numbers of Ukrainian casualties, both military and civilian.
Breaking news this morning, it's war.
One in every six children in the world is affected by an armed conflict.
There's around 230 million children around the world. Many are torn from home and threatened at borders.
Without help, food, or water. Children need to be protected
and live their life free from trauma.
We need to stand up for these children.
Because in war, children suffer most.
We know, because we are refugee children.
My name is Anastasia.
My name is Sofia.
My name is Anastasia.
And this is our story.
I remember this day very, very precisely. I woke up not because of my phone alarm, but because of the words that my father said. He said, like, that's it, they began. And, like, I'll never forget these two sentences.
This is an ABC News special report.
Good evening, and we're coming on the air at this hour with breaking news after the U.S. warned all day of a full-scale Russian invasion of Ukraine.
An unprovoked war in Europe is now underway.
And, like, the most part of the day, we stayed in the bomb shelter. That day, you feel that, like, everything you had before is just destroyed. And you don't see, like, any perspective for what you will do then.
The first moment when things started to get worse, because obviously everybody was panicking and it was just like this intense waiting for your life to be over and waiting for this war. And obviously then it was getting worse and worse. It was absolutely terrifying for a person who never, like, lived in a war condition, because that was crazy to even think about it.
People are not safe in their own homes. This apartment building in Kharkiv.
Till the age of 11, I feel like I don't have any other memories apart from just war going on. I feel like my childhood was, like, ruined a lot because of revolution and then the war happening.
While some Ukrainians in Kiev were heading out of the capital, many are determined to stay and resist.
I had to flee from Kiev to Lviv region, which is safer than where I was born. Then I had to flee to Poland and to Austria and to Germany and France, and only then I came to UK. When I left Ukraine, originally I left without my mom, and then she had to come because I couldn't get visa without a parent. It's really difficult to be here without my dad and my brother, specifically without my dad, because I'm very close to him and he's, like, a very important person in my life. It's just really heartbreaking for me, especially because we were always, like, a very, like, tight-knit family, and he wasn't here for my 18th birthday. He's probably not gonna be here for my graduation. And it kind of feels like we're just running out of time that I could spend together. And I cannot, like, help him in any possible way.
Anastasia left Ukraine to study in Japan. The three girls met each other online in a school project and started working together on different projects.
The week after created our team, the war started, and because there was war going on, we knew that, like, we needed to do something to, like, change this big problem in our community.
And we understood that there are more emergent things that we should do.
But then they were deeply touched by the video of a young boy crossing the border all by himself with no help.
And I think I saw them and we just, like, thought that maybe there's a way to create something that could help those children.
They decided to stand up and make a change. They started creating two apps.
One for young children fleeing their own country.
Through this app, they can understand where they are, call for help, and communicate with local people. And the second app is to help older children who have already reached their destination.
To help them integrate.
And build lasting relationship with host communities.
With our app, we want to help every refugee child in the world.
The three girls live thousands of kilometers apart, and Sofia was still fleeing while working on this project. But still, they work together.
There are, like, these few hours when we can, like,
when all of us are available and we're not asleep and we're not like in the lesson. Before the meetings, we have like this rule that we need to call each other a few times to wake up the person who is sleeping at that time.
So my hope for the future is the fair life when everyone is equal, when everyone can live the life they choose, and when everyone has an access to the opportunities other people have. That's what we and I are fighting for.
Our biggest dream is to like expand the app and make it international so everybody around the world who needs it can use it for themselves.
For this remarkable initiative, which will improve the lives of millions of refugee children worldwide, they are the rightful winners of the International Children's Peace Prize 2023.
I like our work, but it is needed for a very sad reason, and I hope that someday this reason disappears.
Your 2023 International Children's Peace Prize winners. It is with incredible honor that I ask now Anastasia Feskova and Sofia Tereschenko to please come to the podium, and that you will be joined by Anastasia Demchenko remotely.
Dear ladies and gentlemen, thank you for sharing our vision on the importance of children's rights. It's our great honor to receive this award. The International Children's Peace Prize is significant recognition of our efforts and also an opportunity to be heard. This award recognizes the bravery of every refugee child worldwide who, despite hoping for a day when they can finally return to their country, family, and friends, that they are best to integrate into the new host communities. As much as we want all children to have a safe and peaceful childhood, we understand that our reality is different. This is why we are going to continue to work on our apps to be able to help not only Ukrainian children, but also refugee children from all over the world. Together, we hope to create a better future for children, no matter who they are and where they are from. We need your support to turn this into reality. We need all of you to be open to interacting with children from different backgrounds, children who are living in an entirely alien environment for no fault of theirs. It is time that the adults take responsibility for their actions that affect children and the world that children must live in. We need the world to recognize the trauma we all face, to be empathetic to our experience, to understand that the safety and rehabilitation should be the priority in any military conflict. Please remember to show your support to all of those who are struggling right now, and don't forget to be on the right side of history by showing support to those who are in pain. We want to use this opportunity to keep doing what we are familiar with, what we can reflect upon and relate to help all children who are displaced around the world. We will continue to adapt our technology to different refugee conditions and different languages. We hope to be a beacon of hope for all the refugee children out there. We dream of a future where refugee children are treated like all other children, and we dream for refugee children to have a dignified life wherever they are and where they are able to share their experiences with the world. We dream of a future where governments prioritize children and recognize their pain and suffering. We want to express our gratitude to the KidsRights Foundation for the opportunity to raise awareness and voice the struggle of those voices who cannot be heard anymore. The Technovation team, such as Tara Klovsky, Karen Lan, Amy Ernie's Leon, and especially our mentor Daria Tabunchik, for supporting us on every step of this journey and our growth with it. Our families who had to pay a huge price of being separated from us to give us the chance to be safe and build our future. host communities who accepted us during the darkest times of our lives, and Ukrainian defenders who made it possible for us to live and speak from this stage today. There are problems that we, children, can solve, but some are up to you, adults. And we believe in you, and we believe in the world. We know it's hard to know which decision is right, but usually it is the one that feels right. We encourage you to do whatever you can and help others whenever you can. Українці добре знають цінність єдності. Навіть будучи розкиданими по всьому світу, разом ми можемо творити великі зміни. Дякую. Thank you.
Wonderful award winner in her. You have a few words, have a quick chat. Please welcome Anastasia Demchenko.
I feel an immense sadness that I cannot be here with you today and physically share this important moment. But together with it, I feel an enormous gratitude for your support, even though I'm thousands of kilometers apart. We are so thankful for the chance to speak and be heard today. We will continue to work together to help children find peace wherever they are. Thank you. Aww.
Thank you, ladies. Three dedicated young ladies, children, young ladies, I'd like to say, Anastasia, Sophia, and Anastasia, united in their commitment of making a difference for children refugees. And as Anastasia said so poignantly as she was speaking, that she believes in us as grown-ups, as adults. She believes that we can help make the place a better place. I hope that we don't let her down. And now, we have come to the end of this year's awards ceremony. Thank you again, Sophia. Thank you, Anastasia. Thank you, Anastasia. Thank you, Sri Nahal. Thank you, Aaron. Thank you, Raina. Thank you, every single one of you. We did, Mark, Mpo, Ndaba. You are all very, very welcome. Sponsors, dignitaries, human beings connected and committed to continuing those connections. As now, as I ask for the members of Voices 8, and I think a children's choir as well to assemble, I ask you all to come forward as we are going to be singing our traditional song that KidsRights Foundation, in honor of the International Children's Peace Prize, is so committed for. Because the song, All You Need Is Love, is that reminder that the power of good and the power of love is what will prevail. When you think back just a couple of hours ago as we commenced this ceremony, the thought about the impact that one young person at 9 years old watching his father being taken away to prison, how that spurred him not into despair and immobility, but into action. And then what another young man, now 14, saw a news article that there had been a fire that had been ignited by the discard of a battery. He didn't just switch to the next channel or go on a video game. He took action. He mobilized. He propelled others to action. And of course, the refugee plight and the final winners of the 2023 award. We are so grateful to each of you and to each of you to make that difference, to know that the power that is in the Firebird, in within each of us, that is love, not just a feeling, but an action. And so please, once again, Thank you, South Bank Orchestra. You have been amazing. The Symphony Orchestra, members of Voices 8, all of you together, join us in the traditional closing song of the 2023 International Children's Peace Prize, All You Need Is Love.
Attentie, gitaar. 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4.
Not you can say, but you can learn.
Attention, to play the game.
It's easy.